I think I do own the handle P Mac on the street. I think I saved that a while ago, but I've long since probably forgotten the password or what email address it was attached to.
What if someone starts a podcast, though, called P Mac on the street?
Then they'll pay me a lot of money for
it. They can't get a hold of you.
That's Paul's retirement plan. Not to mention, not his very responsible, well,
I have one of those too.
But your quote,
retire early plan is some podcast run by the NHL, I assume. It's like, here, we'll give you $2 million. We just need that handle real bad.
Pierre Maguire?
We need a host, too.
He could be PMAC, couldn't he?
You should try to sell that to Pierre Maguire, and then he'll discover this. And I'm sure he's got boatloads of cash.
We get a lot of shots. Everybody come to the net. We just have to get more and more pucks to the net.
Pucks on net.
Pucks on net.
Putting pucks on net.
We used to talk about in Vancouver getting pucks on net.
What are you saying about putting pucks on net?
Continue to put pucks on net.
Pucks on net.
Put pucks on net and get lucky sometime.
Pucks on net and driving and making a hard night on it.
Live on tape from Geeta's apartment, her palatial estate on the 23rd floor. This is Pucks on Net, Vancouver hockey podcast that doesn't talk about fantasy or fancy stats. We all know now that Paul has the PMAC on the street Twitter handle.
Maybe.
Thank God no one else has it and is extorting him.
Yeah. So
I might not. I think I've got it. Like, I think I would have tried to save it 5 years ago or so.
I'm starting to worry that you went ahead and said, I'm gonna do a real solid for Ryan. I hear they're starting a podcast, and it's called Pucks on Net. I'm gonna get the Twitter handle, and then you forgot about it. Maybe that's the situation.
Yeah, I don't think so, Ryan.
That's also believable. I own that, but I forgot the password, and now I can't tell anyone.
My name is Ryan Chapp. Oh, no, I don't do that yet. I'll be your host for the evening. I guess I could do it first.
Sure.
Joined once again to our immediate left, fresh off a trip to the Oregon coast, is Geeta.
Welcome home, everybody.
Yeah, it's finally we're back home. I have reason to believe that your couch does not like the microphone and cable.
Okay.
Because when Paul and I recorded the Patreon episode and our last week's show at my house... At my apartment, nothing went wrong with that.
Was it me?
I think it's the couch.
Should I move? The new couch doesn't like the podcast.
Yeah, I prefer that you bring a folding chair or you sit on a milk crate and do the podcast.
There is no longer a PMAC on the street on Twitter. I wonder if it got caught in one of these culls in recent years. Because it would have had no tweets or anything.
You were just a bot.
So I guess I've got to save it again. Or one of our listeners now will save it and try to... get the money out of me, but I don't care. So you can have it.
Do you care for $5?
No.
How much Patreon money would you give up?
Let me tell you, I had it.
I didn't
use it. So if somebody wants to pose as PMAC on the street, I'll just get them kicked off Twitter if they're actually posing as me.
I just find that so...
You know Ryan and I are going to now create it and then... Probably
it's gonna be
manage
a horrifying
a Paul parody account.
Yeah, but it'll be like the Eugene Melnick account. It'll just be extremely excited about things.
Oh, I thought it'd be like, this coffee isn't fancy enough.
Matt Duchesne was amazing last night.
That was the one I was waiting for.
And that's PMAC on the street. He's sitting on Geeta's love seat right now.
They're really trying to scare me off. I'm not gonna be on the show next season because of this.
Who's going to replace you? Who can replace
exactly.
you?
Exactly. So you better walk, tread carefully on those eggshells, you two.
No, we'll...
Parody account.
We'll change the picture from an eggshell to a photo of your smiling face.
Yeah, that's the problem. I don't think you're getting this.
That he's afraid we're going to do this.
I feel Jim Rutherford feels the same way about that, whoever that dastardly individual is that runs his parody account. Sorry, his real account.
The weird thing about that one is it turns out to be former employee Sheila that runs the Rutherford account, so we have no control over that, Jim.
Sorry, Jim. I want to thank you for joining us, wherever you got us from. Make sure you follow us on Twitter at pucksonet.ca or... Crap, I got to do this dial. pucksonet.ca or pucksonet.ca.
Ca!
And if you want to support the show monetarily, you can head on over to patreon.com/pucksonnet, where you can pledge a couple of bucks.
Couple of bucks.
I feel it's been long enough that we haven't explained what those sound bites are. Or why we say this nonsense.
You didn't do it last week?
No, we did, but like the reason. Like somebody that's tuned in for the first or second time, like what the, why are they saying that?
Sure. I haven't understood the reason and I've been here for all those episodes.
Wait, you haven't?
I know what they mean. I just don't know why it keeps getting used.
You know what I'm going to get? I'm going to get that exasperated sigh. And then just have that on the soundboard,
too. Well, that's what's going to have to happen next season when P-Mac's not here.
But P-Mac will be here. If you get what I'm putting down with our new Twitter handle, we can get P-Mac bot.
And then we can have seasonal names.
If you want to be, support the show monetarily, patreon.com/pucksonnet, pledging a couple bucks. We have a new Patreon backer this week, Nicholas Brown. And I'm not going to screw that name up. He's pledging $5 a month, so we want to thank Nicholas.
Could be Nicola.
Oh, that's true. And he linked his Instagram account to his Patreon account, so I have reason to believe he is from the UK. So we're big over there.
We really are.
Yeah. So I want to thank you for pledging a couple of bucks.
Where in the UK, though? Let us know on Twitter.
Pucksonnet.ca or Pucksonnet.ca.
Or not at PMAC on the street at McClellan Paul.
Well, who is Paul? Who has Paul McClellan?
There are some other not really famous but relatively accomplished people. Some guy that's like a famous gardener named Paul McClellan. There is a musician in the UK named Paul McClellan, but I don't think he was like famous or anything.
There's a famous gardener?
Well, of some repute.
Maybe he does those like hedge animals.
I think Paul McClellan, just straight up at Paul McClellan, was a religious guy from the southern United States, I want to say. I've looked this up, obviously.
I still have Ryan Shapp, and occasionally I'll see somebody tweet it wrong.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh, jeez. But I have that.
I wasn't able to get Geeta ready.
Who's got that?
I have no idea.
Geeta ready does.
Yeah, obviously.
Or some really weird acronym. You ever know that?
It's really not maybe an acronym. There's a lot of
I assume Geeta Reddy is a... there was an actress I saw on some show the other day, and I saw the name on the credits in the opening. I'm like, Geeta's on this! It wasn't you. I was very disappointed.
It was a different one?
She had a few years on Geeta. She was playing someone's mother.
There are like a gajillion people who live in India.
that is the official number.
It might have been on Doctor Who. It was on some cool show. Anyway...
So we're recording on a Saturday afternoon because in the playoffs, anything that we could potentially record with our honest, heartfelt thoughts and opinions will be immediately outdated by tomorrow.
That's right.
So I said, well, let's record today.
Also because the game started earlier.
Yes. Although I feel it's really sad because we just had those 2 weeks of four games a night and now we don't have those.
Now you have afternoons of two games.
Yeah, and then we're going to be going to one game, and then there's going to be days off in the Stanley Cup final, which likely will feature the San Jose Sharks.
Well, don't jinx it.
Oh, it's just a matter of time.
I'm still picking Colorado.
You think so?
Of course you are.
No, well, I'm assuming I went 1-for-8 in round one, and Colorado was the only one I got right. So I'm assuming I'm going to go 0-for-4 in round two.
Perfect. Pick the Colorado Avalanche.
They
you
were my pick.
Do that.
Colorado, St. Louis. So I'm on my way to being wrong.
We're Dallas, San Jose.
This is an exciting point because all of us have our respective dogs still in the fight in the second round of the playoffs. PMAC, you have obviously Matt Duchene, who's playing his best hockey in a long time.
I'm picking the Colorado Columbus final now at this point.
Geeta, you have Jason Spezza,
who's playing hockey.
He's scoring a goal.
That's right. Yeah. He's winning face-offs. Maybe what? Multiple ones.
Upwards of two a game? What more do you possibly need out of a hockey player? And me, I've got my guy. I've always been a Boston Bruins fan. I got my man Brad Marchand in the line. And he's doing great.
Mm-hmm.
See, I've always been a Boston Bruins
fan. So I'm going to assume Dave's got someone in Columbus?
Yeah, he...
I don't know if Ryan's being serious or not, because I know he used to wear a Boston Bruins jersey around all the time, pre-2011. But I also walked through the streets of Vancouver in 2011 as Ryan was shouting horrifying statements about members of the Boston Bruins, current and former, and I will not repeat them because they were that horrifying.
Well,
so I don't know, is there truth to this Bruins?
Hey.
Brouhaha?
If where there's smoke, there's fire. That's all I'm saying.
Ryan's an anarchist. That's all I know about this guy. That's all I've learned in 12 years or whatever.
An anarchist?
Yeah. When it comes to hockey, he's an anarchist.
That's a really nice thing to say about me, Paul. Thank you.
Okay, let me rephrase that. He liked that too much. He's a shit disturber.
He enjoys that. That one's a colloquialism.
I like the term pot stirrer a bit more, but shit disturber is great. If you've known me a long time, yes, yeah. A shit disturber.
Yes.
But I, in all seriousness, I have gone all in, all my money, metaphorically, and all my love and heart and emotion is going into a team down in the Bay Area that we all is captivating the hearts and the minds of children around the world.
Right.
With their old man that looks like Santa Claus on their.
I really enjoyed the old homeless man series.
Do you like that?
I do. I was like, I wish that's just its own thing.
Maybe it could be. But I'm getting the sense that Joe Thornton knows that this is it. There's no more kicks at the proverbial can. And as an elderly homeless man, he's going to take that can and return it for 5 cents.
It's true. Like, because he's aging. But that window, like, has been, like, just propped open for years now. And we keep wondering how long it's going to last.
Why is that window still open? It should have closed years ago. And it's a big window. It's floor, it's ceiling to floor, wall to wall, just window. And it's just open.
As far as the Sharks go, a lot of people give them a tough time because they've never closed the deal.
Yeah.
But we talked about this last week, I guess, where I'm like, I'm not one of those people that's like, if you're not first, you're last. Because it's a big league. And from a fan standpoint, the San Jose Sharks have been an amazing example of consistency.
Absolutely.
And it's been entertaining hockey for a very long time. And they've constantly brought in new bodies. So even though they've got these old guys on the team, the whole next wave is there. And then the next wave is showing up with, LeBanc and Barkley Goodrow playing a big role and stuff. Like, they do a good job of continually bringing in new bodies.
He's a way better brother, by the way.
Yeah, it's about time a Goodrow made an effort in the playoffs. Like,
he actually spells it G-O-O-D.
That should be the name of... They should rename Harvey the Hound.
Yeah.
Barkley Goodrow.
If they picked him up, then they could do it. But I feel like a conference division rival...
No.
It'd be weird.
They need a positive in Cowtown.
A positive? I thought you realized you were saying that the way you... Anyway.
If I did, I would have said it with such a shit-disturbing, sly tone of voice, and I would have done like a body turn to emphasize it. But also, I'm mesmerized by the advancements in the game of Thomas Hurdle. Tomas Hurdle, who went from being... flashy, no good Nick that scored a fancy goal on Jamie. Who was that? He retired a goalie.
Goal game. Oh,
what was his name? But he was just that flashy, dangly, and now he's like this prototypical power forward that is, filling the void of all the guys that have come and gone from San Jose. And then you forget about Brent Burns, and then you forget about Erik Karlsson,
right?
Who is very hurt. He's looks horrible. I imagine he's not practicing and it's only the second round, but he looks very injured, but he's still playing really well. And this team it's something else to watch and I'm enjoying the hell out of it.
How do you forget about Brent Burns? He's up for the Norris Trophy.
Because he's always so good. Because that team is always there.
I don't know. Drew Doughty says otherwise.
I was going to say, I can't even think about...
Where's Drew Doughty now?
He's tweeting. No, he's just... He's at a bar in London and he's just texting. He's like, this is so stupid. You see Brent Burns, he's the worst.
He's no longer invited to the Shakers.
Yeah, there is a Shaker band. We shouldn't forget that.
But yeah, Hurdle's always been good, but he's grown up. He started in the league so young.
Yeah.
People forget it. So when they see him playing a more physical game now, if you're not a Sharks fan, I imagine, it's sort of like, oh, he's taking important faceoffs. Oh, he's doing that. It's like, yeah, when he started in the league, he was this scrawny little teenager. And people in Vancouver might have something to look forward to in that regard, where an Elias Pettersson type of guy, as he fills out, is going to become that much more effective, you know, taking the important faceoffs and playing a more physical game, being able to push back a little bit more, you can assume, over time, because that might be a similar, as far as their build and type of game will probably develop, will be probably somewhat parallel, but much more potential, I guess.
That's interesting with him, because you have that almost negative way to start his career of showing, you know, hot dogging and showing up and having a coach's corner propaganda strike against him. And then you kind of forget about him, and he's like, oh, there's that little wiener jerk down there. And then all of a sudden you're watching him play huge minutes in the playoffs and be such a force. And he did the Mark Messier, we're bringing it back to San Jose to win it in double overtime, shorthanded. He gets the goal. Like, there's a lot of these things to like on this. So my next question is, what San Jose Sharks jersey do each of you want for me to buy from NHLShop.com with the Patreon money? Is it three jumbos across the board?
I'd like a Kyle Wellwood, please. San Jose. I actually went, when I went to one game in San Jose.
Yeah.
And I asked at the team store for a Kyle Wellwood jersey.
Mm-hmm.
And they did not carry them in stock, sadly. I was buying a souvenir for a friend of mine, so I got a Brian Boyle at the time.
Oh, okay. We've become big fans of him as well.
Big Bri Boyle?
Yeah.
Wait, am I saying the right Boyle? There's been a couple of Boyles.
You and Dan Boyle.
Yeah, the old Boyle, the one that's retired.
Oh, okay.
The old
Danny Boyle.
Yeah, the one that doesn't look like a pirate.
Oh, Danny Boyle. I think they both look like pirates. Anyway.
Yeah, but one's like extra piratey, and the other one's like the gruff older pirate brother that's like, oh, I'm not going to storm in it for that booty. I've done that in my yesteryear.
Yeah, but as far as jerseys of current Sharks, I don't know. Who do I want?
Burns.
I forgot about him.
I mean, people might mistake me for his little brother or something with my beard game these days, so it's maybe pretty, I should go Burns.
It is pretty long. For those, this is an audio podcast, and the visual component that all you have to use to identify the people on the show is the cover art, which was taken in late 2015.
We do not look like that anymore.
Paul's bearded. He looks good in that photo. He still looks good.
I was looking at it today too.
I'm bearded.
And baby faced.
Oh, I still had a gallbladder in that photo.
Mm-hmm.
And Geeta, you look exactly the same.
I haven't changed my hair. Actually, I changed my hair.
That's the only difference. Probably the greatest. I don't know if you guys can think of a better game.
Mm-hmm.
Better than Game 7, San Jose versus Vegas.
Oh, yeah. The game that we had all stopped watching, clear across the board. Everyone changed the channel.
Paul, did you watch the whole game?
I actually was like in and out of watching it and started watching it after the 3-0 goal.
Okay, so you
can't. And I was like, do I want to watch this? And
yeah.
As I was debating whether to keep watching, the penalty happened, like the hit that led to the 5-minute major. And I said, oh, this will be interesting.
Right.
There's potential there. You can score at will on a 5-minute penalty and it doesn't end.
Yeah.
I'm going to watch this. Wouldn't it be wild if they could come back here and score some goals? And they did.
And it was the greatest thing. And I turned it off because I have nothing against the Golden Knights fans, the team. There's a lot of things I like on that team.
But there was an important baseball game on.
I don't think there was a baseball game on. I just didn't want them. I'm like, everything comes so easy to them.
Yeah.
Like, they need some heartbreak.
Totally.
And so they go up 3-0. I'm like, well, this is stupid. I want Joe. You know, I kind of want to see Joe Thornton keep going. And I turn it off and I start playing video game baseball. Mm-hmm. You're right. Yes, thank you. There was a very important video game, a virtual, if you will. And I started listening to podcasts. I look at my phone and I just see it's 3-1. I'm like, oh, good for them. They're making something out of this.
Yeah.
5 minutes later, I look at it again. I refresh and it's 4-3. And I'm like, almost fell out of my high chair that I'm sitting in playing video games. And I went back and watched all the goals. And it was like the greatest, it's the greatest comeback in a long time, in at least 10, 15 years. It was the most exciting third period. It was the most exciting overtime. Like, I couldn't turn it off. I couldn't watch. Ray Ferraro and Gordon Miller calling the game, and they're losing their voice, and like, and or it was Chris Cuthbert. No, it's Miller. And it just, it was, well, first off, it felt like watching old playoff games on TSN before Rodgers, you know, stranglehold at everything. But it was just amazing. And it all came from human error.
Yeah.
And I just want to know what you guys think of the of what happened with the referees blowing this call. Are you upset that that they blew the call, and from a Golden Knights perspective, are you thinking about it from a Sharks perspective, or are you looking at it from an outsider's perspective that fuck up made for the most exciting hockey game, the most exciting comeback?
Well, exactly. And then those fuck ups are going to continue to happen. It's not like it's something you can stamp out simply because, oh, let's just do reviews.
Yeah. They talked about, like, the governor or whatever. The Vegas guy is going to propose that at the meetings, that they should bring in reviews for penalties, which I'm fine with that, but I kind of don't want it. Mm-mm. And I think that, like, some of the greatest moments in hockey history, it sure did suck that the Leafs didn't go to the Stanley Cup Finals in 93, but, like, that's, like, one of the greatest moments ever is when Wayne Gretzky, hacks up Dougie Gilmore and nobody gets a call, and he's skating around like, I didn't do anything. And like, I, as much as I want the idea of getting it right, I honestly, if more situations like that happen, I don't want review.
But also, on a nightly basis, teams kill off 5-minute majors without letting in any goals.
The San Jose Sharks did tweet last night, oh, so you can kill off 4 or 5 minutes of penalty.
They only had to kill off 4 minutes. And if the other team had scored, it would have been less. So I saw that and I'm like, yeah, it's kind of, Twitter, I don't know, the whole NHL team Twitter account's becoming dicks. All of them.
Except the
Vegas
Canucks.
Started it.
Kind of bugs me. Like, I
so,
mixed feelings.
So a little taste of their own medicine.
What do you think about it, Paul? Because you are, by all accounts, you are the resident, call it down the middle. You would like a second, in some situations, you would like an eye from above calling things correctly. I'm very torn. Because I totally understand that it's a blown call. You can also make the argument that cross-check led to him being put in a dangerous position.
Right.
Similar to being pushed closely going into the boards. But at the end, it was not... They judged the penalty based on Joe Pavelski, God bless him, bleeding out of his helmet. And I'm just curious what you think on the matter.
No, I could see both sides of the argument. It was an exciting... You keep saying it was the greatest end to a hockey game. I'd say it's most interesting. Because when you get into greatness, there is a degree of, like... The games are played to reward the better team.
Mm-hmm.
And when something that major happens... Now, granted,
pun intended.
A great team probably should have killed off at least some of that 5 minutes... Probably shouldn't have let the Sharks back into the series in the first place. Mm-hmm. There's that side of it.
Yeah.
But it's also a matter of, like, this is a team that had pretty much sealed the deal on this series, their ticket to the next round. On paper, they're probably the better team the regular season. I guess they weren't the better team because the Sharks got home ice advantage, but it is the type of thing, if you were in that organization, if you were one of those guys on the ice, even if you're
whom?
In the... You yourself.
No, for which organization?
For the Las Vegas Knights.
Oh, I would be pissed. If I was a Knights fan, or if that happened to the Canucks, the exact same scenario, I would be bloodthirsty and I would be angry. And
oh, we'd be irate. And
we would be on, we would have all our phones going to get into 1040. Just to avoid, and I would.
You would have done an emergency podcast,
guys. I don't care that you have that family dinner. We need.
You have work at 5 a.m.
Everybody up right now! It's 11:00.
So it is one of those things. Like, I would like to see the league really move towards making better, faster, more accurate decisions.
Yeah.
But yeah, I. In the from the outsider, from just being a viewer of the situation, I can see the beauty and the imperfection of the league.
Mm-hmm.
And from a standpoint of looking at the Vegas team and fan base, so much when it comes to like luck to a certain degree has gone in their favor in the first 2 years of existence. That, I mean, the sad thing is this is like an awakening. They don't even have a lot of professional sports experience in that city. This is what happens, especially in hockey. Things like it was a baptism by fire. Like they had their good times last season, and this season came to a horrific end. And that's part of the game. Like everyone who's a fan of a team in this league has a moment or two where they like get angry or worked up about some injustice that happened against them, and they should have had a better ending to their story. And this is now they're a real fan base. Now they're a real organization because they've been screwed over by the NHL officiating.
Someone on Twitter called this Vegas's worst season ever.
And well, it was. Yeah, let's be honest.
But we eye roll.
I'm worried because I don't think people in Vegas know how to deal with highs and lows. It's just, I don't know how they're going to be able to, you know, cope with.
That's it. They're turning their back on this team. Yeah. When are the Raiders moving in?
Not for a while. They got to build that.
No one's going to Knights games now.
I'm
going
to be so curious to see what a Golden Knights game looks like on a Sunday when the LA or the LV Raiders are playing that day. Because I think that they like hockey, but football's football. And that's just
in America.
In America, yeah, the NFL draft was the biggest event of the season so far.
Well, it'll be interesting to see the support they get when the team is not a playoff contender. When they have what most teams go through the first few years of their existence, when you're a basement dweller, after the expectations been set so high. Are they going to continue to support a losing franchise in a sport that they're just sort of getting the hang of?
I almost think that a football team being placed in that town is going to be even that much more detrimental to their fan base or their the interest in that, because that's the only thing in town. Let's support them. Oh, wait, football's here. And football is a disgustingly gigantic aspect of the American life.
No, that's the thing. If you're spending $200 for tickets on a football game, do you have that more income to invest in your hockey game?
Well, they're just all
and Knights games are expensive.
Oh, it's wild, eh?
Yeah, I hope it's we're concerned over nothing right now, because you've seen that in other markets.
Well, I'm not concerned about Vegas.
No,
move the team to Kansas City, Ralph. For all I care, put them in Hartford.
They get about 49 million tourists a year.
Looking for air conditioning and a slice of home.
Yeah.
They're going to be fine for a long time.
Anyway, if the fans are truly, you know, fans of the organization, and there are people, I think, who are really throwing themselves into this, and there's some longevity in their fandom, I hope there's enough that it supports a franchise there for a while. Because we've seen in places like Carolina, where when things are good, they can sell out the arena, but then they have rough years. Florida's another good example. When you're missing the playoffs year after year after year, those stadiums are near empty. And there are good fans, don't get me wrong, but there aren't enough to support a top-level hockey team. It's more of like an AHL market. So we'll have to see how this unfolds. But
I don't feel bad for them.
Yeah.
Can you think of a game that you watched that was more exciting or more captivating or just more... Everybody's talking about it the next day or texting you as it happens.
Or are still talking about it like 5 days later.
Like, about 8 years later. Dragon Slayer.
That game wasn't that good. That was like, I'm going to have a heart attack and the whole team's going to get fired if they blow this. And they almost did.
People were talking about it for quite a while after, but yeah. I get what you're saying.
But I showed somebody just the condensed third period in overtime because they missed it. And I'm like, you would not believe what happened. And yeah, 3 days later, you know, just watching on a phone, it was still exciting to watch. And that's something that's totally missing from the game. And the more robotic and more soulless that it gets them, you know, with if they do official or they do review things more. And I worry that we won't have that. And it's just, it kind of rejuvenated my love of hockey, even though that's all I've been doing for the last 2 weeks is watching hockey.
There's still a lot of unpredictability in the NHL, though I think in the regular season, as the debate's gone on, how many games there are, how long it drags on, there are games where teams don't try as hard. And maybe that's another argument to reopen the how long should the season be type of thing, because just entertainment value alone, players are, even if they don't realize it, pacing themselves, or they should to a certain degree in the regular season, and you don't get as many of those wild games, but you still get some. I'd say hockey still opens up the possibility for that more than a lot of other sports.
Looks like Dave might want to join us.
All right.
But that means we can...
Give him a different topic.
It's all about how he was wrong about the Jackets.
Great.
I'll wait for him. I'll wait for his... clear. Just for a quick update about that. Referees Dan O'Halloran and Eric Furlatt, grizzled vets, they did Game 7. The NHL, they apologized to the Golden Knights and said that it was wrong. It was the incorrect call.
Okay.
And then they told O'Halloran and Furlatt that they were not, they're not advancing to the second round.
But do they already determine that, like, prior to... Or is that something they decide on the fly?
I think it goes based on incidents. I know that in basketball, and the NHL has taken a similar model, that all everything's reviewed and they look at, you know, things they got right, things they got wrong.
Okay.
But this is the first time in over 10 years that Dan O'Halloran has not been in the second round. So you could, you know, call it a coincidence or whatever, but I think that...
He's like the Vegas Golden Knights of refereeing.
I think the NHL kind of had to do that.
Yeah.
And that's fine by me, but God bless. God bless. Midway point of the show, make sure you go subscribe to the Pucks on Net email newsletter. Just go to pucksnet.ca and wait for the annoying pop-up to come and get you. We just wrapped up talking about human error in the San Jose Sharks Golden Knights game. And you were an advocate of keeping the human error and the mistakes that in what result from it in the game. And I kind of scoffed at you at the time, and now I basically just reiterated everything you said in years past.
Yeah, you know, it's one of those things where, you know, sports is becoming so sterilized and so much less organic. You know, I just feel like there's nothing wrong with, you know, things not going your way every single time. Isn't that life? You know, sometimes the red light camera catches you and sometimes it doesn't, you know, isn't that just how it goes?
A little bit. Yeah.
You know, cause like sports and life in general have a way of evening, you know, things out a little bit. Sometimes calls go your way. Sometimes they don't. And it makes for great stories and it makes for great memories. You know, the only one that I can think of that was like super egregious that I wish they could have gone back on was the Jim Joyce blowing the Detroit Tigers perfect game by the play at first base by Cali Nile. But that being said, unlike other officials who don't make themselves available to the media, the guy did a press conference and said, I kicked the shit out of the call and I apologized to the kid. And he cried, and I cried, and everybody cried.
We all make mistakes. Give him the Corvette still. He deserves it.
Exactly, and everything was okay. Jim Joyce was forgiven, and the kid, well, I think the guy, it was Ramon Martinez, if memory serves. I think that was pretty much it for him. But, you know, the long-winded, yes, just like let the goalie interference, you know, play out. Let them call it on the ice. If the referee doesn't call it on the ice the right way, then that's that. Like, we had one today in the St. Louis-Dallas game. And the review took 15 minutes. And I hate the fact that it gets reviewed and then they challenge and review it again. It's the stupidest thing ever.
But you got to slow the game down, Dave. You got to make sure that it takes about 3.5 hours to play a game. Everybody can digest it. That's anyway.
Well, that call, even from the original angle, didn't look like it was interference at all.
Well, that call annoyed me because they're like, well, they got to challenge it just because for the sake of challenging it. No, yeah, you don't. No. You watched it once and... Like
there was no questions.
Was that Ben Bishop? He's having a good year. He's having a Vezina caliber year, but he's not that quick where he can fly across the net to get a beautifully placed tip shot. I get it, but I, you know, come on.
No, that one was pretty, you know, it was a bang bang play, but they got it right on the ice. I liked how they handled it. That's how you handle it. You huddle up with the two linesmen and the other ref. You go, what did you guys see? I saw it as a good goal. Yep, we saw it as a good goal. You know, that should be it. The Sharks Vegas thing backing up, because I'm sure you guys waxed on this, you know, pretty hard before you called me. What I don't understand about that one is that there's four officials on the ice, right? You got two linesmen, you got two referees. It happened right off the face-off. So, like, what the fuck else would you be looking at? Like, if there's nothing else going on other than a face-off. So how do eight individual eyeballs missed that call. Like, that's what baffles me and confuses me. I don't understand it at all.
It's they were distracted by the Bad Boys bail bonds bright neon t-shirts behind the bench. They need to ban those, outlaw them. They gotta go.
But I'm right. You don't need instant replay for major penalties. Like, they should have caught that. Like, they don't need cameras to catch that. Like, it was... Like, you know, you're like, there was no behind the play. All the players are within your line of sight, and it happened right off the draw. Like, what else are you goddamn looking at?
I think the other problem is they totally, whether you like to admit it or not, they gave that penalty based on a visible injury. And
yeah, but he had a pre-existing condition. He wasn't insurable. State Farm wouldn't have covered him. He had a full cage on.
Yeah.
Obviously, there was something, you know, wrong with him.
And he's leaking out the side of his head. something going on there. I want to talk about probably, you know, you talk about the most exciting overtime game 7 ever, and probably the least intriguing, dullest, and quite frankly, lack of effort I've ever seen was from the Carolina Hurricanes, or from the Capitals, as mm-hmm. they played the Hurricanes in Game 7. They looked
you guys
like,
all just kind of think they seemed relieved that they lost that game.
I got the sense that they did not want to play any more hockey. And
I didn't think they wanted, because that overtime went long. I was like, oh no.
They looked like a beer league team playing an 11 o'clock game. And there was a part where one of the Capitals had to do a back check. And he's in front of the Hurricanes net. And like, the play is going the other way. And he's just like... and he just starts pumping. Like, the last thing that they want to do is play more hockey.
Definitely, it seemed. The energy of that game.
Yeah.
Well, I think for me, if Washington had taken care of Carolina quickly mm-hmm. and gotten a breather, I think that they would be still a dangerous team and a threat to repeat. Like, right. I don't think this is a failure on them at all. Like, they won a Stanley Cup last year. Carolina just kind of, they're the St. Louis of the East. Like, they're coming in. They've been playing playoff hockey since January. They're all young and jazzed up and on amphetamines and excited.
What is this,
and,
baseball, you know, in the 50s?
They're doing some cocaine about it. You know, they're super hyped, and they're doing it for Justin Williams, who's like Ryan Smith but successful. Like, you know.
That's so true. let's just take a breath on that one.
How is he like Ryan Smith at all?
He's a good, hardworking guy. You love him, except he's successful, and he's got a grizzled vet, and he's a team. He's a Captain Canada kind of mindset.
He can see through the tears.
he goes to the net hard. He's not a fancy player. He's a lunch bucket player, but he wins. He's clutch.
Yeah.
He doesn't win in Helsinki in May like Ryan Smith does.
It doesn't sound anything like Ryan Smith. You're not selling this.
Oh, come on, Paul. We're sold on it. Don't worry. P-Mac, any remarks on the Game 7 between the Capitals and the Hurricanes?
I didn't catch much of that one.
Well, you're lucky, because it was a dull one.
I watched the puck drop to overtime goal, and I concur. It was not that exciting, but, you know, I live in Ottawa, so there's nothing exciting.
You feel obligated.
my apartment got very tidy during that overtime because not much was going
on. Oh, I took a break to watch Jeopardy. So I made it back just in time for the good stuff.
I do quite love the folklore. What's the word I'm looking for here? Of Rod Brendamore, of Rowdy Roddy Brendamore, Rod the Bod. And I was listening to the radio. I was listening to 1040, and Pierre Maguire was saying that Brendamore was in the he was in the gym at about 6 o'clock in the morning, working out in the dark, because he's still in that mindset of player, of just like being in the best possible shape possible. And that's,
ooh, player coach.
He kind of is player coach, because he's speaking his mind. He's very honest. After one of the games against Columbus, he's like, or no, against Carolina, Washington.
Yeah.
And he's like, we're playing like crap right now. And then you could see him in the after the when they won. Yeah, they had the camera in the locker room, and it's like, we got kicked in the, and he looks at the camera, he's like, we got kicked in the ding ding, but we came back and we won. But I'm really liking Rod Brendamore, and like, there were points in the season where he's like, we're playing so bad, even I thought about putting on the equipment and going out there. it's just it's more, it's something we need in the game of that's, you know, that some sort of form of personality. I think it's great.
Hey, does anybody else remember how the Dallas Stars CEO called the, all those pretty boys out for not giving a full effort earlier this season?
Yes, we do.
Whatever happened to that guy? He's been pretty quiet lately. He's like me with the Columbus Blue Jackets, only it's his own team.
He's probably patting himself on the back.
That's what did it. Forget about Matt Zuccarello being healthy right in time for the playoffs. It's my gumption, my positivity, and my motivational tactics.
Does that guy have motivational corporate posters all over his office? Like synergy.
I
don't have those. I definitely don't have those.
The Canes lead 1-0 in the series against the Islanders, which nobody cares about because it's being played in the Barclays Center. And Grandpa Lou did everything he could to get that game moved, or that series moved. And I guess his mafia ties don't go that deep where they can move concerts. But
I watched that game as well. I watched it tee to green. And that was actually, that's a 0-0 game. That was actually fun. That was a goal. That was a goaltending battle between two guys that I've never heard of, and it was spectacular. I think it was Arthur Zerbe versus Gar Snow, right? That's who was in net for the Hurricanes and the Islanders.
I think so. Yeah, that does sound familiar. Now that you mention it,
was it Eric Fichaud versus Sean Burke?
That one, I mean, you have a team of piss and vinegar kids playing offense against, you know, arguably the best defensive team in the playoffs. So that I don't expect a lot to happen in that series. And we talked
about, you know, the reason the Islanders are winning is because John Tavares didn't have Islanders pajamas when he was a kid. So he's not on the team anymore because he only plays for teams where he had the pajamas, and they're doing really well. And they replaced him with Leo Komarov, who was a better Leaf anyway, right? So
that's right. Know. Yeah. Wasn't there another Leaf they picked up too?
I don't know. It's the Eastern Conference. I live out here, but I'm watching the West game, so I don't care.
Yeah, you're not sleeping much.
No, not these days.
Is there anything before we wrap up with you? Is there anything left on your mind about anything on your mind about hockey right now?
Well, we got the Bruins game 2 starting in a little bit, and I think the Blue Jackets. I think it's a case of if they win that game, they win that series running away the first game. Mm-hmm. And I don't know. I'm doubling down on my dissenting of the Columbus Blue Jackets. I'm predicting that Boston wins a game and wins again tonight, and they wrap that thing up in 4 or 5 games. And Matt Duchene signs elsewhere in the off season. I don't know where he's going. I'd like to see him personally follow Jason Spezza into Dallas, as I made a comparison earlier this week that they're pretty much the same guy, just split about 10 years apart. They're the same player. If you really think about it, if you look at Spezza in his prime and you look at Duchene now,
Paul,
they pretty much bring the same, like, great but not awesome, good but not great level of hockey.
What do you think about that? You're our resident.
I don't know, that description, that's just like, they're really good second-tier offense players. That's a lot of guys.
Paul is skeptical of you.
After that Justin Williams thing, he's known for winning important games, and Ryan Smith's known for losing them. I'm still stuck up on that. It's like they're all perfect opposites.
That's pretty funny.
Well, you know, Paul, you and I are pretty much the same guy. You know, like you're like the Nazem Kadri to my John Tavares, and I'll leave you with that.
All right, but we'll let you go. But thanks for joining us on this matinee show. Survive the floods, eh?
Oh, I'm in the penthouse, man. I'm in a higher floor than Gita's place. Good.
Do you not need to go outside? Where and
he can't. He's still wearing his Toronto Maple Leafs pajamas.
That's true. Well, it's actually not raining out right now. It's pretty nice.
Oh, it is quite nice.
So
there,
go
yeah.
Pull out your rowboat.
Yeah, and go listen. The Ottawa 67s. They've been filling up sandbags for you all day. You're gonna be fine.
Yeah, no, the flooding really hasn't hit. That's a Quebec. That's a Gatineau problem. That's Quebec. All their roads are busted anyway. It doesn't matter. It only improves things.
All right, bud. Have a good one.
All right. Bye. See ya.
Speaking of the Ottawa 67s, have you been following that?
It's now time for everybody's favorite segment, the Pucks on Net Junior Hockey Corner.
Is that actually on our rundown? I didn't read it this week.
I mean, we're only a couple of weeks out. We're only a couple of weeks out from Memorial Cup.
Paul, you didn't read the rundown?
No, you make me come in early on a Saturday. You expect me to read? yeah, I wanted to talk about them the past couple weeks, but they're headed for the OHL final. Have not lost a game.
Yeah, that's
and
pretty
Mikey
wild.
Mikey DiPietro is the one backstopping them to this undefeated run in the playoffs.
Yeah, they loaded up. I know they did the standard WHL thing, and he is 12-0. He's at a 2.26 goals against, which in the O is pretty impressive, mm-hmm. and a 9.13 save percentage with a shutout. And they are 12-0, and they spent all of Friday filling sandbags to help flood reliefs. But also, that's going to be a good workout, a good solid upper body workout. So I think they
and legs. Lift with your legs.
That is smart.
Except there are a couple guys don't know how to lift. You're gonna have bad backs.
Mikey DiPietro, it's something about a lower back injury. They
out for the rest of the playoffs.
And closer to home, the Giants just beat the Spokane Chiefs. They're off to the WHL Championships.
Amazing. Is that a road trip?
Okay, here's the thing.
Yeah.
I wanted to go last night.
Right.
I wanted to go for game one.
Yeah.
I wanted to go for basically every Friday comes up and they're playing. And I'm like, I really want to go. I don't want to devote my Friday night to that. It's too far away.
This is true.
And I really want to go. I even want to go as fans. I don't want to be like, yes, we need some esteemed media passes and buffet tickets. We'll need 6 of those, please. Like, I just want to go as a fan and yell and watch junior hockey, but it's really goddamn far away.
I think they sell Trading Post beer there too, which is the Fort Langley Brewery. It's like good quality stuff.
Do you want to go this Friday?
Maybe.
I will pose this question on Wednesday.
Okay.
And then we will commit to a Friday road trip.
Okay.
And oh,
what?
We could potentially meet you.
You could pick me up on the way.
Now we're cooking with gasoline here.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, if you train halfway, I will pick you up.
Well, I mean, if Paul's coming.
Geeta doesn't look impressed at the thought of me coming.
Wait,
that's
three?
It. I was like, Paul?
Paul?
In my car.
I don't think I've been in her new car. I was in the
you
last
have,
car.
Mm. Yeah, I would. I really want to go.
We could try. Well, let's check in on Wednesday.
Yeah, because that is for those that are not from the West Coast, that is how flaky we are. We don't mean to be, but it's like, I totally want to do that. I've been wanting to do it for weeks.
Think about your Instagram story.
Oh God, it'd be a good story. Both accounts. I bet they got Wi-Fi.
Ooh, it's not that far a drive. I've been down in like South Surrey 4 or 5 nights in the past 2 weeks. So
no, it's getting the
you
whole.
You know what? You come halfway here. Do your daily podcast.
PON daily only on Patreon. That is not confirmed yet.
It's going to be on the rig explaining why Ryan Smith never was Justin Williams.
And then come meet me after work.
I like that comparison. I think that's pretty good.
You would.
I like making fun of guys that cry and lose. So.
I don't get how that's anything like Justin Williams.
He's the opposite.
Exactly.
Grizzled vet that wins compared to grizzled vet that loses.
So you know who's going to Europe? Joy Stutcher.
Is he going?
Yeah.
Oh, good
for
him.
Just got the invite this morning. Last night.
Matt Murray's going to go. So is Mark Stone.
Okay.
Because his body was, you know, he had a lot more hockey left in him, mentally prepared. Mm-hmm. And then like a bunch of Canucks. Quinn Hughes is going. So is Thatcher Demko, who got re-signed this week.
Oh, but they're not playing for Canada.
Yeah, that's a good job, guys.
Yeah.
You know, it's hard to get emotionally invested in them. And then Ryan Smith will be playing as well.
Obviously.
That's not true. The Russians have a really good squad this spring.
Is Ovi going?
Ovi's going. Malkin's going. Vasilevsky's going. Like,
I like that the Russians Kovalchuk. Are really patriotic.
Yeah, when they won the World Hockey Championships a handful of years ago, and yeah, it was after Sochi because they were miserable in the Olympics, and I do quite like that too.
You know, historically, Russians have loved rolling into Slovakia. Shouldn't. I'm sorry. So sorry.
Went by a different name back in the day.
Yeah. I mean, they're still Russians, but
they all went by different names. Yeah.
Hey, you guys want to join a union? Great benefits.
I'm sorry, Paul. That really hit me in the funny bone.
It's political. We've gotten in trouble. I'm not going to make any, even if it's 70-year-old political jokes or whatever.
No, that's not political jokes. Those are historical jokes. You can make those.
There's a line that gets crossed, I guess, where it turns into history.
Well, I mean, you could cross that line from history into political. You're like, that being said, some of their ideas weren't that far-fetched and could be applied to today's society.
Are you talking about the new Avengers movie?
No, I'm not talking about the new Avengers movie that I don't know what's... Apparently, it's a big thing.
Ryan would be a Thanos supporter, wouldn't he? Chaos.
Thank you. Shit disturber.
It's not a compliment.
Always on the wrong side.
I went opening night to the Avengers movie.
Don't spoil it.
I haven't.
When are you going to see it?
Maybe Tuesday, maybe next weekend.
Maybe Friday. Oh, I see what's going on. Yeah, got a lot of irons in the fire. I get that.
I looked last second on opening night because they just put a theater in by my house. And there were front row seats available, which I haven't sat in years. Mm-hmm. It took about 10 minutes to get used to the weird aspect ratio of being that close. But once I got into it, it was actually kind of fun to have it right in your face like that.
I agree. I think I saw like Mission Impossible 2 in the front row.
For that type of movie, and it was close enough that I had to move my head to see what was going on all over the screen.
Yeah.
When there's big battle scenes and stuff, it feels like you're like right in the middle. It's a different experience, and it would have been horrible in 3D because the angle would have been off.
You would have,
but
it wasn't
3D. That's what I don't like watching 3D movies.
You need to have the right seat.
Yeah.
3D is affected by, you can't sit on the sides. You need to be like dead center.
And I feel like I hate the glasses on top of glasses.
I've sat dead center for 3D movies and it's just blurry. I just don't like it.
That also depends on the movie.
Yeah.
Yeah. That concludes Pucks on Net Junior Hockey Corner.
We ended it a long time ago.
Nope.
You just kept going. We talked about junior hockey-ish topics.
So there's some rumors swirling that came around yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
I was having lunch table for one at the NAM, and Dave texted me and he goes, "What's the deal with all this Mike Gillis talk?" And
he was trending.
I went, "What?" And then, and I was like,
it's been like 3 or 4 weeks of this, though, it feels like.
No, I didn't. I had no idea. This is the first I heard about it. But basically, Ed Willis at the province, so you know it's legit. Mm-hmm. He said Aquiline has reached out to Gillis via text, slight possibility he could return. And then there was also a rumor from, I believe, the PatCast that said the Canucks reached out to Lombardi so much last year, he told them to stop calling. And then in a Trumpian-like tweet, he goes, Aquiline, he was like, "I want to correct erroneous media reports that I tried to hire Dean Lombardi. In fact, I've never spoken to Dean Lombardi in my life." And if those reports are true, he has never spoken to him in his life because he wouldn't just pick up the phone call.
Basically, the only thing that tweet is missing is hashtag fake news.
But then when I saw that, I'm like, where did this, like, I love seeing tweets that are about something else and you're like, what is this all about? And you have to do the research. And then, I don't know. It kind of makes me think that maybe they are talking to old MG if they're putting out something like that.
Would he want to come back?
I want him to come back so bad. That is exactly what I want. I want him to be the president of hockey operations.
Because of the chaos. Ryan's a ultimate agent of chaos, remember?
No, this is the exact opposite of chaos. We have a Canucks fan base so divided, much like any aspect of anything in social media. It's like the political.
It's like civil war.
We have a civil war.
No.
Now he's trying to sell us chaos, but saying it's not chaotic.
I'm talking about Captain America's Civil War when the Avengers were
right
divided.
Now, Ryan's like, there'll be people in the streets of Vancouver tearing each other apart with their bare hands on both sides of this debate. It won't be chaotic at all. That's what he's doing right now.
No, but you're gonna have two sides joined together as one. You basically have people that are like your Benning apologists that everything he's doing is great. Here's a list of players that are here because of him. And then you have the fans that decree that Mike Gillis built a team through intelligent, savvy business, greasy, underhanded decisions, which he kind of did.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something that Jimbo can't do. Mm-mm. So you bring in Mike Gillis to be all smart. He brings in the sleep doctors. He brings in those floating deprivation tanks. And they start winning games. And then you'd say, Jimbo, go scout in the QMJHL for 6 months. Yeah, okay. And then that's it. And then they wheel and deal. And he says, hey, this guy's good. We should trade for him. Okay.
I don't disagree with everything you said, but I think you're leaving some parts of the equation out.
I choose to paint with broad strokes, Paul.
Okay, I'm not sure what he means by that. But okay, here's
facts meaningless.
He's throwing paint at a canvas. And he's calling it art.
Yes, abstract.
Thank you. Okay,
so if this were to happen,
yep.
I don't mind the idea because all along I said Mike Gillis probably should have been an assistant, not like the general manager, mm-hmm. but he should have been in a position where he could implement all these outside the box thinking things
yeah.
and be a part of the decision making group. But the problem was you had him coming in as a rookie, raw general manager. He's been on the other side of those conversations, but isn't 100% familiar with
right.
being inside an organization because he hasn't done anything and worked his way up. So if he comes back into a team as a president, that's that type of role where he can bring in all these outside the box extras where you're investing in your players through creative means and trying new things out. But the part you're leaving out here, and you are saying they're going to send Benning away to spend his winter in Quebec.
Sounds great. Have you been in Quebec in the winters?
No, I've never been to Quebec.
Oh,
I'd like to go.
You'd love it.
You've never been though either.
No, but I've done some Wikipedia.
Yeah. So if he comes in as the team president, I see that as a way of the Aquilinis getting rid of Benning without it falling on them. Because it's much like when you bring in a new general manager and they get to hire a coach. And you go, well, he's got to bring in his own guy. He's got to feel comfortable with his system. If you bring in a new team president and it's Mike Gillis, he's going to let Benning go and ownership will be, you know, well, you know, we brought Mike in and he's going to bring in his own guy. We don't want him as general manager, but he knows who he wants as general manager and he's going to get someone with more experience than Jim Benning. And Ryan's, you know, but this is, again, your chaos thing because you're originally pitching like it'll bring all of Canuck Nation together in unity and love. But no, the result is going to be Benning will find himself on the way out mm-hmm. or if he sticks around, it's going to be very much like Ken Holland in Detroit, which I don't think we got to this part of the conversation. I wanted to last week mm-hmm. where I could see them trying to push Benning into another role with the organization. Mm-hmm. I don't know if he'd do that. I don't know how prideful a guy he is, but yeah, you could make him head scout or something.
This is an audio podcast. So right. Could you just describe what I've been doing with the last 90 seconds or so?
He's trying to look like Mr. Burns or something when saying excellent.
I'm very excited about everything you've been telling me.
So
it's exactly what I want.
That's how I see it laying out. And I don't see it necessarily being an awful decision, but it would then rely on who gets the job as general manager if Benning finds himself on the way out this summer or mid-season next season.
You go to Jimbo and you say, listen, you've given up a lot. You haven't done the best job in this rebuild. And yes, you've done a very good job scouting and drafting players. And we want you to focus on just that.
Mm-hmm.
You can be fired. Yeah. Or... You mean you phrase it nicer.
Right.
You don't
you phrase it like they did with Ken Holland, where it's like,
and
it's a lateral move. It's not really a demotion. You're just going to be doing something different.
Jim,
you're the headest of scouts.
Yeah, Jim.
His contract would open up in a similar way where Ken Holland now can sign anywhere he wants, but he still has a secure job
yeah.
with the Red Wings. If Benning did take that, it would be the same thing. If any other team wants him, he can move on.
I don't think any team would pick up Jimbo as a GM.
I don't think so either, but crazier things have happened.
He doesn't have the best demo reel.
He's got a Willie demo reel.
Willie got another job in the NHL, albeit an interim one.
And he didn't get the job out of it. He was just there.
But he still was handed the keys for half a season.
Because they had written the season off.
I'm not saying it would be a good decision. But the fact that anyone would hire Willie Desjardins after everything that happened shows that some guys can get a job after a less than stellar performance.
But he did win a medal at the Olympics.
Not the one he was supposed to. What are you trying to sell me, Ryan Smith, by telling me he's Justin Williams? Willie Desjardins is not Mike Babcock, and I'm not even sold on Mike Babcock being the greatest.
Oh, he's pretty good. Just like his players are good players, he's a good coach. I want exactly that, because last week I said, how do we do this that we get Jimbo's mind for prospects and drafting in our system, in our organization, but we don't have him front and center making business decisions and trades and signings, because he's not good at that, and he's has a track record of not being good at it. This is that. This is everything I wanted. And if you're a Patreon backer, and you should be, you can go look at each week we post our cheat sheet, our notes, and I wrote as a conversation topic for last week's show underneath Steve Yzerman coming in as GM and Ken Holland getting demoted, how can we make this happen in Vancouver? So we've manifested this to happen. Mm-hmm. I want this. It's not going to be chaos. It's going to be perfect. Because then you're going to have all your guys, and I'm, you know, good friends of mine are Benning apologists, or they are blind supporters of him, and they're going to love that hockey mind, that old school, good, smart, good eye for talent is in our organization.
Right.
And then you're going to have the other people that you know that go, I cannot stand how the decisions he makes, the short-sightedness, he should not be manning this ship. So you bring in the guy that did man the ship and made the best, helped build, well, didn't do it all himself, the best team in Canucks history, and they work together in a hilarious odd couple scenario. I don't care how much chili pots they're spilling and how funny it is or not, but I just want that. I think that will appease everybody in this fan base.
Speaking of this fan base, the announcement of Elias Pettersson is one of the nominees for the Calder Trophy. I'm just getting this psychic message. I'm seeing the future.
Yeah.
And he's going to lose. He'll be the runner-up to Binnington. And I'm going to predict also that Quinn Hughes ends up being the runner-up to Jack Hughes in the race for the Calder 2020. And the Canucks will have three consecutive years of having the runner-up for the Rookie of the Year.
Brian Burke disagrees with you. He doesn't think Binnington played enough games.
I would still pick Pettersson if I were voting.
But his games were so impactful. I my spidey senses, because I'm sure that he's one of the Avengers.
He is.
Is he?
Yeah. Spider-Man is.
Damn it. I was hoping he wasn't, so I could make
Batman.
A joke. My Batman, my Bruce Wayne senses are tingling, and I don't think, I have a feeling.
Yeah.
I'm not going to be shocked if Binnington wins the Calder. Binnington.
I bet they split it.
I just feel like people are going to go, well, he only played 27 games, but they were meaningful games, and they got him into the playoffs. Last place on January 3rd. Look at them now. And it's a great argument, and I totally agree with them. And I just think that they are going to, Ottawa is going to override everything that Elias Pettersson has done, and it's going to suck.
Yeah.
That'll probably unite the city.
And the
we were wrong.
And when was this fan base the best? When it was the Canucks against the NHL.
Yeah.
Alex Burrow's getting screwed over, the narrative against the Canucks. This is going to, much like human error, uniting fans, loving the San Jose Sharks and overtime hockey, them screwing Pettersson out of the Calder is going to unite us as one again.
Pettersson is one of the only things the people who are overly critical of the organization, along with everyone in the middle, to the blind cult followers of Canuckdom.
Pettersson
Canuckism.
Is our Vegas Knights.
Everyone agrees that Pettersson's great. I don't even think Binnington's played too few games, because he's a goaltender, and typically rookie goaltenders, if they play more than 25 games, are having a fantastic season and should be, if they're putting up those kind of numbers, in the conversation.
I believe he's played 32.
Which is, for a rookie goaltender. Yeah, there's all sorts of stuff. He's a lot older than Elias Pettersson. Elias Pettersson looked more prolific.
Yeah. 32 games.
They're both great players. That, in the end, it doesn't really matter who wins trophies. Trophies don't matter that much.
For a decent sample?
Yeah, and I mean, because they're saying Demko is likely going to play 25 or 27 games next year. You have a 32 games for a rookie.
Yeah.
And
a 25-year-old rookie.
And the games a goalie plays are that much more significant and impactful and important than that of a center, because they don't play every day. It's tough, and it's gonna. I think it's gonna bite the Canucks in the ass, but it is gonna unite us as one. Fight, 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 blue, green, and white. Am I right?
Also, yeah, I mean, and as bad as St. Louis looked on paper, they're a better, more solid team than the Vancouver Canucks were at any point this season. So people don't take that into account. They just look at that record, the fact that they were last in the NHL. They don't take into account a bunch of guys took a big step up and took him to the playoffs. As good as he was, a lot of guys on that team were playing well beyond our expectations, or at least where their expectations should have been in the offseason going into the season, as opposed to October, November.
I think that this show might have exceeded our expectations this week. I don't know about you guys.
Meh.
That was Paul, come on, man. You're like a successful Ryan Smith.
I've still got a cardboard cutout of Ryan Smith somewhere. I might have recycled it, actually.
Now I understand the lukewarm response to Dave's comedy, because you're a...
He's a Ryan Smith fan.
Yeah.
No, someone gifted that to me.
He's more of a Jason Arnett.
Who is Ryan Smith?
Ryan
Smith. What number does Ryan Smith wear?
94.
What number does Matt Duchene wear?
Mine is a 9 jersey.
Oh, shit. Well, I'm just trying to get an Illuminati conspiracy theory going on here.
Illuminati? What year is this?
When was Matt Duchene born? 94.
Ryan is an agent of chaos, and now we're finding out he's a member of QAnon. This is, I don't know if I can do this show anymore.
Come on.
Quinn Hughes was the last thing. As soon as he saw a player and, you know, Q Hughes, Ryan was set. It all must be true. The end is nigh. He's on a street corner preaching with a piece of paper.
Sorry, what, BMAC on the street?
I see these things because I'm walking around on the street looking like the beefcake I am, and I see Ryan with his end is nigh and a big Q sign.
And then I'm just like, I'm yelling and I see Paul. Hey, Paul.
See you at the podcast.
Yeah, see you later. I'm all dirty and disheveled.
What has become of my life? Who am I spending my time with? If you weren't here, Geeta, would not have shown up.
Oh, come on. Jeez. He makes good points. I am a creator and cultivator of chaos. That'll wrap it up for this week's podcast.
He spells chaos with a Q, too. It's ridiculous.
You want my one last bit of chaos I was thinking of creating? Was I was listening to our outro song. It came on Shuffle.
Yeah.
And I was listening to a different part of the song. And I'm like, I should start the outro music at this point.
Okay.
Instead of at the beginning. Mm-hmm. So do I throw even more chaos in and change the outro with the same song but different edit for the first time in 230-ish episodes?
I'm surprised you're even bringing this up. Aren't you the master of chaos?
You're right. It fits right into my motive. Chaos. Then it will be agreed. There will be a different outro at the end of this show, which is probably happening right now. And with that, Cass, make sure you follow us on Twitter at PucksOnNetCA.
It's a weird episode.
Or PucksOnNetCA.
Ka!
What do you think about that?
What did I think about what?
You just said just nothing. If you want to support the show monetarily, you can head over to patreon.com/pucksonet, where you can pledge a couple of bucks.
Couple of bucks!
And once again, we want to thank Nicholas Brown for his $5 Patreon monthly donation. We'll get him instant access to our upcoming 5 minutes for paying.
I just remembered you did some big lead-in where you're going to explain your soundboard, and you never actually did. That was like...
Save it for Patreon.
Yeah, if you want to know what the fuck's going on with this
guy
soundboard.
And his chaos is just too much. I don't know how we have any listeners. How does anyone understand any of this?
They all think they are all in on the jokes.
They know. They've been around.
They know.
So we'll have 5 minutes for paying on Patreon after this. And we also, PMAC and I just recently did a bonus show. And you can get our show notes and this and that all behind the paywall. Make sure you head on over to pucksonet.ca for all our latest articles and posts. And that's the easiest way to sign up for the PucksOnNet email newsletter, where you get one email a week of non-spammy material outlining everything we've done and a little bit of this, a little bit of that. And follow us on Instagram, because we're trying to be socially active there. And if you don't want to give us any money, just head on over to the Apple Podcast Store or on iTunes and leave a 5-star rating and a positive review. That's a great way to support the show, because, Geeta, it helps us defeat what?
The Bill Gates. Not Bill Gates, Steve Jobs algorithm.
That's right. And you want to talk about chaos. That algorithm has created more chaos than I ever have.
I don't use iTunes. I haven't used iTunes for podcasts in years.
What do you
but
use?
But I am still using Windows.
Overcast. I sent you the link a while ago and you said you're going
to
try it.
I have it on my phone, but then my devices started talking to each other. Paul, on Overcast, can you get our podcast?
Yep.
Really? That's great. We're also on Spotify, wherever you get your shows from. Now, enough chaos for one day. Let's go into 5 minutes of pain.